Greetings, everyone. I'm here today to do a little Q&A video for you all. Since I am not the typical YouTuber, I dance as opposed to video blogging, I oftentimes get sent a lot of the same questions. And a few weeks ago, I posted a video to my YouTube channel inviting you all to go ahead and ask whatever questions it was that you really wanted answered from me. So I brought those all together today, and Winston, of course, never more than a few feet from me, is here to help as well. So any snoring and grunting that you hear is from him just taking one of his 12 afternoon naps. I'm sure he'll be up soon to help us again, as he usually does. So of course the question to start with is, how did I start pole dancing? Ironically, this is probably the most difficult question for me to answer for you all, because I don't have that typical story of, you know, I saw this amazing video on YouTube and I had to give it a try, or, you know, my friend brought me to this class and I fell in love with it. Mine is different in the fact that really pole and I just kind of found each other at the right time. I had a lot of things going on in my personal life, which I'm not going to get into in this video. But I was recently diagnosed with an autoimmune disease, and I also had just recently given birth to my son, which I was very, very sick through. So I was really looking for something to challenge myself, to really kind of reconnect with myself, specifically my body at the time. And it also really needed to fit in with my life at the time, and you know, that having a newborn meant that I really couldn't be gone very often, and it had to be something that I could do in my spare time when I could find a free minute to do it in. Now here's this really strange part is I actually had a pole, and I hate to say this, but I don't even remember buying it. So that's how much of an impact it had. I think that I got it right before I got pregnant, and you know, I never used it. It was something that I didn't get to. It was a 50 millimeter static brass. So, of course, when people came over, kids would come and they just wanted to play on it, and brass needs to be cleaned. And so, you know, I spent my time cleaning this thing, not bowling on it. So at some point it went up in the rafters, and I remembered that I have this pole up in the garage, and so I decided to bring it down, and it can only reach so high, so it can't be put in my upper level. I have to put in the lower level. So I have a ceiling height of, like, I don't know, whatever the standard, you know, like 6 feet is. And I put a little bit of time into it, and I was enjoying the challenge of it. A few weeks in, probably 3-4 weeks in, I decided that this is something that I do want to continue doing. And so I wanted to get a professional piece of equipment. And I ordered myself an X-Bowl, of course, with spin and static options on it. Because I had been strictly on static up to that point, and I really wanted to kind of have the option of spin and to see what that was all about. So when this new pole came in, it was tall enough that I was able to put it in my upper level, which was my living room at the time. And so I had a little bit, I had quite a decent amount of room. There was still a couch, you know, maybe 4 feet from my pole, but it was up here. I had all the beautiful windows. It was just a lot more comfortable of a space. And so, of course, I had been on static this entire time, you know, the 3-4 weeks, whatever I had put into it. And I really wanted to see what spin was about. And that, for me, when I grabbed onto that spin pole and started going around, that for me was what really, in my mind, began pole for me. That was like the hook, line, and sinker for me. Whatever it is about spin and I, we get along. Some people really feel dizzy and chaotic and out of control in that space when they first begin, and I felt the opposite. I felt control and I felt power. I loved working with the you know, the forces of gravity and centrifugal force, and it just, my body adapted to it very well. And I spent a lot of time just experimenting. The closest pole studio to me, I had begun to look into at that point after I knew that I really wanted to continue doing this. Closest pole studio was just about 2 hours away one way, and at the time that was completely not an option for me. And so I had to self-teach, which was not an issue for me. I'm a great self-study. I prefer to self-teach. I'm a very independent learner. And so that all worked for me. And so with how well that worked for me, I continued to do that. So I am, this is answering a question that a lot of people ask. I am completely self-taught, with the exception of my instructor's licensing. So at this point, I've been polling about 3.5 years, which is going to lead me to probably the second most commonly asked question of, do I have any dance background or experience prior to starting pole dance? And of course, probably the second hardest question for me to answer, because that's not a cut and dry question either. In ways I feel like no, and in ways I feel like yes. So I had some ballet as a small child, and point. I stopped ballet right after I began point. And apparently I had some gymnastics as well, but I was so young that I don't even remember that. So this is how young I was, you know, under 10 years of age. So the formal dance training that I had, you know, lives in my early childhood years. That gave me a foundational understanding of movement and, you know, the beginnings of the teachings of really knowing the body's full capabilities. Now, after that, I started violin very early at a young age. I played for just about 10 years. That really gave me a deep understanding and connection with music. Then a little later in my college years and thereafter, I modeled for about 10 years. Now, that gave me exceptional body awareness. I think that has a big piece of who I am as a dancer as well. Throughout my entire life, I've really been involved in the arts, whether that was photography or painting or metalwork, jewelry, decorating, pottery. I've always been doing something creative. There was a short time in my life that I was not, right before I began pole. But my entire life I've been heavily invested in the arts. So I have this kind of amazing pot of experiences that I'm able to draw from and apply to my dance. So the answer to that question really is a yes or a no. And I think that the important part is that we all have that unique pot of experiences in which to draw from as dancers. So a lot of people ask me how my flexibility was in the beginning. It was pretty awful. Like, I was not flexible. I was not active. To be completely honest, before I got pregnant with my son, I was even a smoker. I had unhealthy habits. I was, you know, eating fast food, not getting adequate sleep. It's just not taking care of my body in a sense that I now understand that I should be. You know, I was doing what most people do, and it wasn't working for me. And so that leads me to a question that I am asked all the time as well. My diet philosophy, whether I take supplements. I'm not a nutritionist, so I'm only going to speak for myself here. And, you know, that's a really tough question to address, because I think it really only involves individualistic answers. I think it's different for everybody. What's right for me isn't right for you. You need to find what's right for your body, your ethics, and your current health state, as well as your own personal needs and goals. Myself, I am personally a vegetarian. Near vegan, I have a real hard time giving up cheese. I do really enjoy it. And ironically enough, I live in a dairy state, but vegan cheese is not something that is something that I can just go and pick up. I personally eat a vegetarian, gluten-free diet focused on organic and whole foods because that is what works for me. And I apply the theories of my eating and my cooking to my body and my environment, everything around me. So I try to follow the rule that if I wouldn't put it in me, I don't put it on me. So I do avoid certain products. I am very knowledgeable about what I am putting in and on my body. And the things that I can improve upon or make better, I do myself. So I make a lot of my own household supplies, from toothpaste to laundry detergent. I do, of course, all of our family's cooking. So this takes up a good portion of my day. So I do take a calcium and glucosamine usually a couple times a week. You know, I'm not strict on anything. If I remember it, I do it. You know, if I don't, I don't. I did after I started polling. I was losing a lot of weight. I was working my body so hard. I was actually getting really, really thin, and I needed to add actually more calories to my diet. So I got this right here, this raw protein and greens organic plant formula from Garden of Life up here. And this is not something that I sell or anything like that. This is, you know, I don't share things with you guys that I don't use. And I have really, really enjoyed this. It's all good stuff. It's from real things, real food. And it has some probiotics and enzymes in it. This has really worked for me. I've really liked that. So if anybody is at that point, you can take a look at that. Maybe it'll help you out as well. So really the best advice that I can give is, you know, we're all at different places. And we all have different goals. You just need to start with something small. No matter who you are and where you're at, just pick something that you would like to change and make that change. And as you do that, it becomes easier and it grows and your whole life ends up changing. So just remember that one small change at a time really, really leads to big transformations. And the great thing about eating healthy is that once you get there, and it is hard to get there, but once you get there, you feel good. You know, you really feel good, and you can eat whatever you want. Like, I could care less about calories or what I haven't been on a scale in well over a year. You know, it's not something that I concern myself with. I concern myself with being healthy, being as healthy as I can be. You know, this is not to say that I am crazy diet lady by any means. Like, I eat pizza all the time, you know, all the time. But I keep everything in check, and I make sure that the ingredients are things that I want to be putting in my body. So again, it's difficult to change these things, but it's so very much worth it. And when you get it into your routine, it's, you know, your old habits are just that. They're old habits. All right, enough about diet. So I was asked who my favorite pole dancers are. Now, I have to start with this woman, and I don't even know how to say her name, what she posts under. I don't know if it's Mariki or Mariki, or I do not know how to pronounce it, and I'm really sorry that I've completely slaughtered your name. But I ran across her on Studio Vina a few months into my polling adventure. And I had never seen her dance before. This is the first video I've seen of her. And the title was Good Pole Day, I believe. And there was something about the way that she danced that just really, really, like, this was my first inspiration of pole. Like, you know, if I am half as good as this woman at some point in my pole career, like, I will be happy with my accomplishments. She just danced with such grace and ease and fluidity. The most beautiful lines she had on heels, and she just, the lines were amazing and beautiful. She looked like this elegant deer dancing on a pole. I know that sounds weird, but it was something that I hadn't experienced before. It was sensual as opposed to sexy. It was soft and tender, and not a lot of the things that you typically see in pole. And it touched me so deeply. And she really was one of the first pole dancers to truly, truly inspire me. I also love Marlo Fiskin. If you have ever seen her Glass Drops video, if you haven't, go take a look at it. There's her movement as well is just fantastic. She does beautiful work with her flow series. In this Glass Drop video, there's this Titanic shoulder mount climb that she does from Titanic up to shoulder mount into tight. It's incredible. If you haven't seen it, take a look. It's beautiful. Lola Grace is also she's one of those people that I could just watch dance all day long. Her movement is so unique and organic and interesting. She moves in a very unique way. Giannis Marshall also as well. The passion that he puts into his dance. He's a very talented choreographer, but just to watch the joy of dance in his expression and his entire body when he dances is it's exceptionally inspiring. Lou Landers also is such I love the solidity in her movements. Bendy Kate, of course, her flexibility, her work on canes, and just her overall roundness when it comes to aerials, very, very impressive. Anybody who poles is really inspiring to me. It takes a lot to pole. Pole is, it's a high impact sport. There's a lot to it. It's very frustrating. It's very hard on your body. And it takes a certain type of person to pole. So really, huge disrespect to anyone that poles from me. That's just how it works. I find the work of the best just as amazing as watching somebody, get their first invert or shoulder mount. It's all the same. It's beautiful. It's a wonderful accomplishment and a merging of mind and body that has taken that person an incredible amount of work to get there. So deep appreciation to anyone who does this sport. So on to the next question. What type of pole do I use? I use X-Pole. I think they make a fantastic product. If you are unfamiliar with them, you can check them out at www.avamadison.dance/xpole. I will put that down in the comments. And here's probably a good place for me to say that, if you are considering pole, there are some people who basically there's a lot of options in poles that you can get out there. If you're serious about this in any manner, just don't waste your time and money. Go and get a professional pole right off the bat. It's going to save yourself time, energy, and possibly an injury. It's really important to have safe aerial equipment and rigging. People ask me a lot about my poles because they look a little different. If you've watched the evolution of my dance, I started out with a typical dome placement on the top. And both of my poles are now in permanent mount. So that's why they look a little bit different out there. So they're right up through the ceiling into support that's up in the attic up there. And if it is an option for your home, I do highly recommend it. They are amazing. The maintenance is just a lot easier. They're so secure and so snug. I love my permanent mounts. I really, really do. Grip aids. Lots of people asking about grip aids. So when I first started pole, no idea what to do. I got one of each. I got powder, I got a liquid, and I got a wax. The powder, total waste of time. I use powder for my liras, and I use wax for pole. A lot of people use dry hands, which it does work. It does work. But for me personally, it was destroying my hands, and it's kind of a chemical, you know what storm. And so that wasn't a long-term option for me. So I did use it for a while, and it did work for me, but I do not use it anymore. I then went to a mixture of this dirty girl poultice here, which is a powder. You put a little bit on your hands, wet hands. So I put my hands under the drain and get them wet, put a little bit of this powder on, rub it in, and then I usually stand in front of my fan and it dries this white powder on your hands. That with a combination of either the dry hands or eye tack in the beginning when your grip is still not really good, it's not really solid, and your hands are not accustomed to the pull yet. That worked for me for a while as well. Now at this point, and for quite some time now, I have just been down to eye tack. It's what works best for me. It is wax based, so it's nothing horrible for me. And it doesn't destroy my hands. I have pretty decent looking hands for an aerialist, I think. So a lot of different options. Those are the ones that I have found the most useful on my own personal journey. Where do I get my pole wear from? This is just something, it can be anywhere. I have stuff from all over. You know, I have stuff from Frederick's, I have stuff that I've bought locally. I really like the fit of Bad Kitty. I do have a lot of Bad Kitty. You know, and some things I just pull together on my own. For those of you who have been watching for a long time, you know that I just do weird wacky things every once in a while. Like, you know, I always do a Christmas video to, I want a hippopotamus for Christmas. It's just, it's this thing that started and I do it every year. It's just these awful striped socks that make me slide and fall all over. It is the hardest thing to dance in. And it's just become a tradition though. So I do that every year. This last year I did a Halloween video where I did a bunch of different costumes that I pulled from here, there, and everywhere else. You know, I do have two children, so I have this bin that I can go through. And so, you know, the witch costume got a lot of attention. That was just a combination of, you know, an old Halloween costume and some old, you know, nighttime type of wear that I had put together, and you know, some pleasers. And so it comes from everywhere. And you know, when you guys ask, I try to direct you to where it is. But I mean, some of the stuff I've had from modeling, and some of it is new. And I also really enjoy buying from you pollers that create your own. There's a few ladies that I know that have, they're starting their own line of pole wear, and that's always really fun to do and try and also support. So I try to do that as well. Lot of creative things out there. So that's another thing, you know, just if you're comfortable in it, if you can pole in it, you know, have fun with it. Do I prefer dancing in heels or barefoot? And why? This again kind of depends. I don't have a straight up like I like dancing more barefoot or in heels. It's really more of a mood thing for me. You know, if I'm feeling more lyrical, I go barefoot. I feel like I can move a little bit better in that area. But if I want to be up on my toes and I really want to be doing a lot of pirouettes and a lot of pole work and you know, then I put on heels. I love them both equally for different reasons at different times. And so just like anything else, I go with what I'm feeling during the day, because, you know, if there's something I've really learned out of this, it's that you can't force it. A lot of you know that, you know, I paint, I write, I do some other things. I dabble in hand balancing and silks and lira. And it's been hard for me to set a schedule. I've done the schedule thing, and it does help you advance, but for me, what works the best is really just doing what I feel like. You know, I can have everything planned out the night before, like tomorrow I'm gonna do this, you know, I'm gonna whatever it is, and I wake up the next day and like that just does not sound interesting to me today, and I've forced it, and it just doesn't work as well. It's better for me to put it off for a couple days and do what I'm really feeling. So that's what I really wake up every day focused on. It's movement, but you know, I also let what feels right, be a very large impact on what I choose to practice every day. So a lot of people then of course ask, you know, how often do you pull and for how long and every other question under the sun about this. And again, I just do what feels right that day. You know, there, I mean, to be honest, I've had a week here and there that I don't do anything, you know, and then there's other that you can't get me away from it. You know, I'm pull 5 times that week. On average, I pull 2 to 3 times a week. I do a little bit of hand balancing and I'm trying to pick up some lira. I do some silk sometimes. And, you know, of course, there's stretching and everything else involved in this. So you really just have to listen to your body and do what is right for you at the time. A lot of people ask me how I stay fit. And at risk of being a little cheeky here, I'm going to do it anyway. But this question always surprises me. And I think pole looks easy to a lot of people, and once you try it, it's not. Even in my own experience, I've had, you know, of course, friends and whoever come over, or, you know, you can even see it with students when they first start, too. They think that they're going to be able to do something, and they go up to it, and it's visible. It's very visible. It's just, it's like, wow, you know, this is really hard. I mean, you have to consider for a moment that an advanced poller is moving, you know, they're lifting and pressing and twisting and rotating and pulling their entire body around a 360 degree plane. You know, that dynamic tension is bound to change the body. Like, pull changes your body more than anything else that I've seen. And not only is it amazing for your body, and this is the part that I didn't understand when I started, is how incredible it is for your mind and the teachings that pole has, how that radiates out through the rest of your life. It's really life-changing. Becoming a dancer is not, it's not just something you do. If you are really passionate about it, it's a lifestyle. It changes everything. It changes your relationships externally and internally. When you're pushing yourself all the time, I think past what you once thought was possible, that changes something about you. You realize the power that you have, and things don't seem as hard anymore. But all of that, all of the, you know, the mind, it's part of it all. You know, that's a whole nother blog. I guess to sum it all up, pole, or, you know, dancing in general, any movement practice, it's a form of moving meditation. And it is whole body, it is whole mind, it alters your life. It really does. I was also asked, what are my other hobbies or passions beside pole? And to be honest, I'm really, really busy. Pole takes up a lot of my time. Of course, YouTube and my site and everything like that takes up a lot of time. Also, the lifestyle that we choose to live, a lot of that responsibility is, of course, on me. And that involves a lot of cooking for us and the way that we eat. And so I've gotten fairly good at cooking over the last few years here. So I'm always making something, from, you know, tofu to cakes. I even learned how to can. So I can my own salsas and pasta sauce and, you know, jellies and jams, and I'm always futzing with something like that as well. But, you know, what really moves me is, of course, art, you know, any art that really touches me. And the ocean. I love the ocean, the smell of fresh cut grass. You know, I enjoy my tea in the morning, and, you know, sometimes a cocktail on the swing in the evening. I'm truly a girl of simple pleasures. I do have my advanced open water diving. I'm an advanced open water diver, though I haven't done it in a few years. I do enjoy that. You know, we take a lot of bike rides. We play bocce ball in the backyard and have a fire and, We go to the water park and all things of that sort when you have two children at the age that we're at. So, oh, that's another question. Children, I have two children. Though you don't see a lot of my daughter, I do have a 12-year-old daughter as well. She just recently actually went through knee surgery, so she is just getting back to running recently. And she's been bugging me to do a video with her, so I'm sure you're gonna see her again soon. But she's also at the age that she's at. She's heavily invested in her friends and things at school and everything else. So I get a lot more time with my little man who is going to be starting school this upcoming fall. So I'm still enjoying that toddler time with my wee one. And so yes, two children. So I get a lot of questions to pull after birth, since I do have a little guy running around. I did start pull shortly after I had my son, and pull was new to me, so it was what it was. I just worked hard and kept setting goals and kept moving forward, and I am where I am now. I was also asked, have you ever doubted yourself or felt discouraged during your pull journey? And they basically just went on to talk about, how from time to time they feel like shit about their progress. And so just the simple fact that somebody asked that, I absolutely have to answer it. Yeah, quite often, more often than I guess you would guess. To me, I've been doing this long enough that I have accepted that feeling as part of the process. We're alive and everything is cyclical, and it really just is. I mean, at some point you get to be on top of the world, like you got something new, you're feeling great about your progress, like everything is just the way it should be. But we all know that life really doesn't stay that way for very long. And the flip side, way down at the other end of the spectrum, is feeling like, yeah, like, what am I doing this for? And yes, I have all of those feelings. And we generally live somewhere in the middle, and sometimes we bump over here and sometimes we bump over there. And I've just accepted that that is part of this process, and everyone goes through it. They really do. But you really have to remember that you can't be the best at everything. You really can't. This is a very complicated sport. You're not going to be the strongest, most flexible, most lyrical, most whatever, all of these things. You are who you are. You are where you are and at where you're at, You have to learn to draw from yourself internally as opposed to externally. And for some people that even means occasionally turning off the social media and everything from the outside. If you're coming to a point that that's making you feel bad, take a break and really get reinvested into why you started pole, and what you love about it, because that's ultimately why we do it, because we love it. And it's totally natural and normal to go this through all of those feelings, no matter where you're at. The best of the best have these feelings. You just have to continue improving yourself and working towards whatever goals that you have. And again, just take a look and remember how far it is that you have actually come. And that this is a journey. It is a process, and there are ups and downs in that process. And really not to let it discourage you to the point of feeling poorly about yourself, or looking at yourself in a negative manner. Just don't allow that to happen. And I suppose some of the ways that I do that is, if I get really frustrated with something, I do take a little break and switch my focus to something else. If I just am not feeling pole, I can spend the day doing hand balancing, or I can just say screw it and take a nice long bike ride with my kids. I think it is important to accept that feeling as part of the process, because once you do, you recognize that it isn't where you are. It's just where you feel at that time. But it's not the reality of the situation. I get asked a fair amount about how my friends and family members responded to me polling once I first started versus now, just in general, things of that nature. And I guess, you know, I've seen people deal with the whole array from support to the complete opposite. And for me, I guess my road is somewhere in the middle. My family stays fairly quiet about it. It's not something you can miss when you come into my home because, you know, a good portion of it is set up for aerials. So when people come over, it's just, it's a part of the space of my living space, which I can't avoid. That be family, friends, or the cable guy, you know, it's just something that I have to deal with from time to time. And now that I'm more seasoned, that means, you know, nothing to me. You know, there's a few circumstances where, you know, I still do have to deal with that. But that is going to be opening the subject to a bunch of other things. But really, they're quiet about it, and there's good and bad in it. That makes it feel a little lonely at times, because when we go out to dinner or, you know, we're at a family event, nobody comes up to me and is like, oh hey, you know, what's happening new in your world, you know. We talk about other people's jobs and you know, businesses and life events and everything else, but people stay away from it, and it's unfortunate. It really is unfortunate that it makes so many people that uncomfortable. But I mean, we have to accept doing what we do, regardless of how we do it, that there are a lot of stigmas surrounding pole. And you know, my friends, it's a little bit different because I was much more of a social butterfly prior to beginning pole. So I have lost a lot of connection with my real life friends because, you know, I'm so much more invested in myself now, and it takes up a lot of my time. And so from my friends, I do get a lot of, well, I miss you, but I'm glad you're happy type of talk. And my family, again, it's more quiet. It's not something that, I mean, when I say quiet, I don't want to give the impression that they don't agree with what I'm doing or anything like that. But the part that for me personally is still a little, you know, is that it's not something that I get to really talk about, you know. So there's this huge part of me, you know, what I spend a lot of my day doing that I really don't get to discuss with them. And it's something that really, now that I've had some time to settle into this, I've realized that it's important for me to have online connections as well. I've realized that regardless of how supportive your family is or isn't, you still need polers. You still need people that are aerialists that you can talk to and identify with and have these conversations with. Because regardless of how supportive someone is who does not do aerials, you know, there's that connection that just isn't necessarily there, you know, like, hey, I got my first Phoenix, you know, I've been working on this for 4 years and I just got it. And, you know, a person who is not doing these things, working towards these things, they don't necessarily understand it. So instead of having any sort of ill feelings about it all, I have just learned to recognize that I have both. I have a community of aerial friends that I'm very close with, you know, that I get together with occasionally, I have a large community online of people that I deal with and talk with and can bounce ideas off of and learn from and feel really supported in. And I think that's really important to have both. And I think it's important not to expect too much of people who are not aerialists, or who are not doing this or who don't understand your work. Of course, that is a different scenario when people you are directly living with, whether that be, you know, a spouse or parent or girlfriend, boyfriend, whatever the case, you know, of course that changes things very dramatically, and that's something that you're going to have to hit head on. But in an outward sense, I don't worry about it too much. I've learned to, you know, really appreciate and recognize the people who I truly, really, really do connect with. And that's what we're here to do. A lot of you asked, you know, am I going to be making a series of pole dance teaching and whatnot? When I started teaching, I really discovered that my love for pole lied in turning off my mind. When you learn pole, you learn a trick and you learn a move and you learn it so wholly that you can do it with ease. You can do it, you know, from different transitions, from different entries, with different exits. And it becomes, you teach your body to do something, to move in a certain way. But then to really make that into dance, into something moving for an audience, you have to rely on your instinct to deliver that. So when I freestyle dance, I'm really not thinking. You know, freestyling for me is really about body on, brain off. And so, like I was saying, when I started teaching, I really realized that my love for teaching and for pole really was deeply nested. It resided in that area, and ultimately that's what I wanted to share. So over this time, I have actually been writing something. It's going to be a large piece that I will share with you all eventually. So that is what I'm working on right now. Also, as you know, quite a few of you know, I do paint, and I have been asked to, if I'm going to be selling my synergy paintings, there are some paintings that I do on the pole, and I am considering doing that. I have had a lot of things that I've had to deal with business-wise related to AvaMadison.dance in the last month here, but I just purchased myself some canvases the other day, and I am considering making those available on my site as well. But I'm really, really focused on getting this writing together. That's one of the first projects that I want to complete before I move on to the next thing. So whether or not I'm going to be doing a series of specific moves from, you know, beginner to advanced, you know, that's something that will come a little bit later. I am really focused on getting my writing together before I move on to something else. So do I ever get negative criticism for pole dancing and having children? Yes, I do, occasionally. I am very fortunate in the fact that, you know, I am involved in my community. So I don't have just a bunch of, you know, whoever's saying weird random things like you see on a lot of other places. I'm really invested in you guys. Also, probably a little known fact about my community and channel is that from the beginning, I have naturally maintained an 80-20 female to male ratio. So a lot of you are women, and all of you are very supportive. I get the random person, and the more exposure I get, the more this happens, who, you know, needs to say something about something. And, you know, just because I pole dance, it doesn't matter. If I were cooking, if I were making necklaces, I mean, it's all the same thing. You know, somebody is going to be ribbing you about something, and the more exposure, like I said, I get, the more I have to deal with it. But I'm very, very fortunate. I do not have to deal with it very often. And when I do, I try to take... when I do feel like I have to respond to something, I try to take an educational approach. You know, whatever it is that they're attacking, I try to explain. You have to understand that there's, you know, there's so many people stuck in the stigma. And I guess the most important part when it involves my children is that they're most certainly not going to grow up shaming or fearing their bodies or other people's. And I'm not going to let somebody judge me negatively for wearing the same thing that I would to a gymnastics meet or the beach, you know, in front of my children. I am only doing things that are healthy for myself and my family. You know, it's comments like that that, you know, I do occasionally take the time to talk to people about, because, I mean, it's really how people in the sport fall victim to uneducated stereotyping. So, again, as I said, I try to take an educational approach. And I also, you know, you have to remember that these people, you know, they don't know me. They don't know how amazingly well-rounded, you know, my kids are, or how we live our day-to-day lives. And I make every attempt to appreciate other people's opinions and lifestyles. I mean, every day I have to deal with people whose lifestyle choices I completely disagree with, but it's not my place to say. Yeah. And again, I don't have to do it often. And, you know, I think, I don't know, the last time was probably a few months ago. You want to see me get into it with somebody, go take a look at the what happens when I try dancing on a Sunday family pole dance video that I posted. Oh, this woman. Well, if you're interested, go read it. So again, it's just, you have to just stick to your own guns and your own feelings. And it's a really, really hard thing to do, but you know, I'm not doing anything wrong. I am only doing things that are healthy for myself, that move me forward. And I know this, and I hold this inside of me. So anything that anybody has that would be ill-willed is simply misunderstanding. You have to remember that you're not going to be able to touch everyone. You know, it's like that saying, you could be the sweetest, most beautiful, best-tasting peach in the world, but, you know, not everybody likes peaches. You can really only meet people as deeply as they have met themselves. So, I mean, it's not really my job to set people straight in my mind. You know, every once in a while, if somebody directs something straight at me, I'm gonna come back. And I try to do that in a polite and respectful manner, because they're the best way towards anything changing is going to be a change in education and exposure, you know, which leads me into other things. Like people will ask me, you know, can your neighbors see you? Because I do have an outdoor swinging pole. And yeah, they probably can. They probably can. They also see me, you know, mow my lawn and, you know, have fires and, you know, take walks with my kids, you know. I'm not doing anything wrong. And I think to feel that way, as hard as it is, when you feel that way, that comes with a feeling of shame, and I don't have shame for what I'm doing. I am doing something that is only healthy for me physically and mentally in every way. So I am not going to behave like I am doing something wrong when I'm not, and I'm not going to feel that way. And also doing that and acting that way, you know, it really gives people the wrong message. So I think it's important to project yourself and what you do in a non-shameful, very open, let's talk about it manner. That's the only way that we're going to change some of these stigmas that are surrounding our art. And, you know, that brings me to a quote that I ran across a few years ago by Dita Von Teese. She said, it's not about seducing men, it's about embracing womanhood. And I think that's really a core fundamental of pole. A lot of people's minds, they wrap around that stereotype. But when you're actually doing it, it really has nothing to do with that. It has nothing to do with sex or seducing another person, unless you want it to be, you know. It is what you want it to be, and it will be what you make it. I you know, my own personal style, I do like pole to be elegant and graceful and light and lyrical. I put a lot of emotion in my dance. But I also like it to be sensual without being overly sexual or provocative. That's how I prefer my pole dance. That is my own personal style. And really the whole thing is just about my own personal growth, from within my body and within my mind, and pressing myself forward in both of these aspects all of the time. That is what pole is. That is what pole does for me. It really does not have to do with sex, or it doesn't even need to be sensual at all. There are tons of children's pole dancing classes, and as long as you have a responsible, educated instructor doing that, it's no different than gymnastics or any other sport. It's a beautiful, wonderful thing for the body and mind, and children take to it fantastically. They're bendy, little explorative creatures, you know, they're amazing. So, advice for young pole dancers and beginners, you know, what's the most important thing for a beginner to learn? I think, you know, a lot of people are probably looking for something more physically specific, but I think the best advice that I can give is to really enjoy the journey, the process, not to just focus on the end goal. And really, that the most important part to understand is that each of us possesses our own special gift. We all have our own special piece to bring to the dance table, and what we're going to share with people in and through our movement. And every one of us has the ability to pull from our own personal experiences and strengths and weaknesses and emotions, and just really our individual life experiences. And all of these things within our own unique body contribute to the uniqueness of those individual dance styles. That's Winston's individual dance style right there. But through the workings of this bodily discipline in conjunction with our experiences, we create this unique language that is called dance, and we all have a unique one. So I think really trying to find your own personal style and what you love, and, you know, explore the whole gambit and toss out what you don't care for or you're not great at, you know, and focus on what you do like and what you are good at. Of course, always be working on the things you just are rotten at, but, you know, if it's time to let something go, let it go. And there's always going to be a point of time that you feel lousy about yourself and about your progress and everything else, and that is also part of this journey. It's growth, and you really just need to remember that you are perfect right where you are, and all you can do is move forward, and you have to start from where you are. That's the only place you can start from. So hopefully that will give you a little bit to chew on for a while. And now I'm going to reverse the dialogue and ask you a question, which you can leave in the comments below. I'm interested to know how you found my channel, what you like about it, what made you subscribe, or what brings you back. You know, what is it that you have found interesting about my channel? And I think Winston and I are going to call it a day for the Q&A, and probably go take a walk.
Oh, no, big boy.
Yes. Can I say goodbye? Can I say goodbye? No, he's still sleeping. So, I hope you've enjoyed getting to know me a bit better, and I look forward to hearing from you all. Ciao.